Thank you for giving me an opportunity to come to this wonderful city of Prague. And yes, hello everybody. My name is Eddie Held and I work for Perils in Zurich, and I will talk about what we do in a few minutes. But I want to start with maybe something very simple and to talk about data and the importance of data. So it's back to basics. So nothing complicated, nothing too technical. But just to make us aware that, you know, with poor input data, we might have a problem. And I want to, you know, talk about the problem first with some concrete examples, then talk about the reasons and the challenges for that, and then to come, you know, to the solution and conclusions. So that's what I plan to talk in the next maybe 15 minutes. And, you know, cat models, and you all have seen something like that or similar pictures, 3 or 4 box model. You need information as an input. The output would then be something like a loss frequency curve, which you need for premium and PML calculations. So you have, just very quickly, you have the scientific part, the hazard information you need, how often, how intense the physical world will you know, make an event happen. On the right-hand side, you have the exposure. You need to know what is insured, where it is, insurance conditions, and you need the vulnerability linking the physical world with the insurance world. And my next 3 examples, concrete examples with real numbers, show, you know, for each of the boxes, if there's information missing, that, you know, you will have a problem. And I want to start with modeled losses for Australia. So tropical cyclone and earthquake in Australia. And what we did, we asked the vendors, so CoreLogic, RMS, and AIR, in this case, to calculate market losses with our exposure data. So the exposure data was kept fixed. And what you see here is for red is for tropical cyclone, that vendor number one would say once in 200 years, a market loss is $9 billion Australian dollar. Vendor number 2 would say 11, vendor number 3 says 15 billion Australian dollars. The same for earthquake. So you see the difference on the wind side is maybe a factor of 1.5 between the highest and the lowest. On the quake side, it's a factor of 3 between the highest and the lowest. And yes, this is a mistake. This should say hazard. The key reason here, so exposure is the same, cannot be the reason for that, and it's really the view of the hazard. And that's the situation in Australia. If I go on to a historic event, Maria, we have heard about it earlier today, hitting Puerto Rico mainly in September, and you will have followed some of the disclosures from the vendors and others on market losses, and the range was from between 15 and 85 billion post-event in the weeks following the event, so a factor of 5. And I would say the main reason is the exposure data and probably vulnerability. So not so much the hazard, because there was a footprint of the gust value, so this everybody used the same hazard component. And finally, earthquake, 2 earthquake events, some of you might remember, in Italy in May 2012, so 6 years ago, where all the vendors published loss results post-event. And these are the 3 numbers here. So 40, 80 and 180 million euro insured property loss. And we, Perils, collected loss information from 75% of the market, produced a market loss, and it was 1.2 billion. So a factor of up to 30. And obviously this is, and here it was really the exposure data was the key issue, because again, the event was known. This was all past event, post-event, maybe vulnerability as well. So I would say quite a modest model performance in these 3 examples. And all 3 are well known, I mean, especially Hurricane North Atlantic is the best understood, should be the best understood peril. And even there, we had this factor of 5. Also, Earthquake Italy should be one of the best understood with a earthquake catalog going back a long time. So, what are the reasons maybe quickly for this situation? Maybe One is that our expectations are too high when it comes to model output. We would expect to get a true value, and it's never the case. We would also expect the models to be very close to each other, and it's also not the case. So maybe we should be more cautious, and I think the industry has realized that over the last 10 years. And you know, one solution could be to use the models more in a with a relative measure. Example is that you look at the portfolio, compare it over time. This is something you can do with the models, or for risk selection. Another reason for that situation, and you know, that's also known, there are always surprises. And you, if you compare the models on a probabilistic level, they are very close. But when it comes to a realization of an event, when you look at the historic event, at the real event, you have huge differences. And this is really because each event will contain surprises which were not part of the model. So this needs to be kept in mind as well. Third reason, I think there's a bias to a too optimistic model. And you know, you can clearly see that in the cat bond market, where the most optimistic vendor is always used. I would say that's quite obvious. You can also see when there are model revisions, if there is a revision leading to a more conservative view, there is usually a lot of discussions and noise in the market. On the other hand, if a model becomes more optimistic, you know, there is not much comments done. But the most important reason, I think, and I come back now to data, is that there is just not enough input data to have high quality models. And I know many of you are working on that, and many in the industry are working on that, and it is improving. But if you really look then at, you know, what happened with Maria or the other events, there is not enough data, and the effect on the modeled result can be significant. And so, you know, the solution is really to have real data to validate your models. And this validation can happen on the exposure side, it can happen on the vulnerability side, and it obviously can happen for the resulting losses. And you need real data to validate your model. Otherwise, and I hear that a lot, you know, some models are validated with other models. So if you validate a modeled loss with another modeled loss, I think the benefit is limited. And that's exactly, and I come now to perils, why we were set up by the industry 8 years ago in a joint effort to get it off the ground. We operate now independently from the shareholders you might see here. But the industry realized, and this was after Kirill, a big windstorm in Germany, 2007, that there's a lack of data, and there needs to be an organization collecting the data from the insurance industry with all the confidentiality agreements necessary, and producing market data for the exposure and for the loss in an anonymized way with a certain geo resolution per line of business. And you know, our mission is to increase data availability, exactly to allow to get better view, a better risk assessment of the cat risk, to get better models. We have, in the meantime, we have expanded a little bit. So we produce these market exposure and loss databases in 16 countries. So we started with European Wind, but added Flood UK, and then Turkey, Australia, and Canada. And you know, our data is really used by the modeling community to validate the models. A second mission we have, and I will not be talking a lot about that, is that with the data we produce, we can facilitate alternative risk transfer. So things like cat bonds or ILWs or collateralized re, where there's the need for independent source of data or an independent so-called reporting agency when it comes to transactions. And you know, this has both has worked extremely well, and as was expected 8 years ago, we had about 25 cat bonds using our data be it for the risk assessment, be it for the index, the underlying trigger, because we are the index source. And we had about 250 ILWs with a total of $14 billion of limits, which were issued to the reinsurance or capital markets. So this is what we do, and but you know, in this context here, it's really about improving the model quality. And you know, I come back to that example of Italy. And would we not have done the work we did, the modeling community would have sticked to this here, and the models would have been calibrated with those estimates. And you know, I think for future events, there would have been a problem. So we really think that we can bring value, and our data is really needed when it comes to improving also the stability of the models. You know, because the industry has a problem if there a model is an update of a model and is a big change in the output. And you know, I mentioned that already. So you need the data for all three elements. So for the exposure validation, vulnerability validation, and also for the obviously loss validation. And just one slide on vulnerability, which is linking really physics with the insurance world. And this is a European winter storm, not one of the big ones, but I think it was about a 300 million euro event. This is data, this is real data out of our database. So you see on the x-axis the peak gust values, the physical intensity, on the y-axis the mean damage ratio, so loss divided by sums insured. And this is data from Germany. So each dot here is a two-digit postcode in Germany, a Cresta zone. For each postcode, we have the three values you need. We have the loss, the market loss, the market sums insured. So we calculate the loss ratio, and we plot it against the peak gust, the representative peak gust value in this Cresta zone. Blue is building, red is content. So what you would expect, you see it here, the higher the peak gust values, the higher the mean damage ratios. And this is really the core element of each model, is this vulnerability function. And so far, very often, these were derived from academic studies, from engineering studies, and not from reality. And this is reality here. So it's a cloud of points. It's not a perfect curve. But you know, for this example, Germany, we have about 15 events. And for every event, for every line of business, you can look at this graph, and you can come up with your own view of vulnerability. Yes, and conclusions. So, you know, hearing you and following the discussions this morning, I could have added some points here, but just to summarize here, so different views on hazard, vulnerability, or exposure will lead to significant different outputs, obvious. And good input data is key when it comes to the quality of the output. And so more data allows for better models, and it will also increase insurability. And it will also make it cheaper, and it will lower the price, because it's just, because these 14 billion euro of limits, which were added to the retro and reinsurance market, added supply of capacity. And this was only possible because there was new data. So more liquidity, more supply, and lower prices of risk transfer. Next, yes, to obviously more better models is better for efficient and effective risk management and management of model changes, what I mentioned already. And yes, and that's where we come into the play, and we hope to help the market. Okay, thank you.